platform, portraits of the 1961 Mississippi Freedom Riders. This is an interview with Eric Etheridge and Dr. Joe Schumann. Those of you who are here for the first time, I introduce Joe, who's a leader here at the New York Society and also the Bergen County Ethical Culture. He's an activist in the field of immigration rights and asylum, and an academic also in the field of human rights at Columbia University. Eric Etheridge is the author and photographer of Breach of Peace, Portraits of the 1961 Mississippi Freedom Riders. This book contains the mugshots of all 329 riders arrested in Jackson, Mississippi in 1961, as well as his contemporary portraits and short profiles of 99 riders. The book was originally published in 2008 and was re-released in 2018. After the book was published, Eric co-created the Mississippi Freedom 50th Foundation, which organized a week-long series of events in Jackson and elsewhere around the state to mark the 50th anniversary of the riots. The May 2011 event was hosted by then Mississippi Governor Haley Barbour and Representative Benny Thompson, who represents the state's second congressional district. More than 90 riders attended with their families, in addition to several hundred high school and college students from around the country. Before photography, Eric worked online and in print as a journalist. For a year, he wrote a daily online column called The Opinionator for the New York Times. And prior to that, he created around websites for Microsoft and Clear Channel Entertainment, among others. He started his career as a magazine editor, working at Rolling Stone, Harper's Magazine, and 7 Days and many other publications. He grew up in Carthage and Jackson, Mississippi, and now lives here in New York City. It is my honor, and we are delighted to welcome him here today to discuss this with Joe. Thank you.
I do want to stand closer to the slides. Thank you, David and Benita, for the music. That was great. It's great to hear. The music really was the lifeblood of the civil rights movement in general, and especially the Freedom Riders. You know, they sang on the buses to keep their spirits up, to stay happy and stay focused. They sang in the prison cells in Jackson and in Parchment. Singing always got them in trouble. Rip Patton, one of the Freedom Riders, told me he was a musician himself in college. He played the drums in Tennessee State and also played jazz, had a jazz band after the movement for a number of years, lived in LA. And he said, you know, we sang, the music, he said, always got us in trouble. You know, the guards would take their toothbrushes away from them. They would take their mattresses away from them. At one point in Parchment, they took their clothes away from them. They turned off the plumbing. And he said, you know, that singing, you know, what, it was a little stinky after they turned the water off because they couldn't flush the toilet. He said, but the singing, we just kept on singing because they couldn't handle it. So it was a weapon as well as an inspiration. And the song that we're going to close with later today, if you maybe heard them rehearsing when he came in, Buses Are Coming, was written in the Jackson City Jail on the spot once the riders were first arrested. We'll see in a second. This is the cover of the new edition of the book. As Hazel said, it was reissued last year by Vanderbilt University Press. There's some flyers on the table over here. We're not selling books this morning, but you can order it online from Vanderbilt with a very hefty discount. You can also get it with Amazon. This is kind of the same discount. You can also get it from Barnes & Noble, you get your local bookstore to order it. It's around, it's available, please check it out. This is the same as the first edition, except for it has more Freedom Riders featured in it than the first. And we will be sitting down to talk to Joe. I will be sitting down to talk to Joe in a second. But this is really a visual project. And I wanted just to see a few of the mugshots, which are really the heart of the enterprise here. The book is kind of a yearbook of the Freedom Rides, and the mugshots of all 329 people who are arrested are arranged in chronological order as they came into Jackson and got arrested. So this is the first group that came on May the 24th, from Montgomery to Jackson. If you know your sort of generals and lieutenants of the Civil Rights Movement, there are a few famous people here. James Bevel in the top corner. We've got David Dennis right here, who ran Mississippi Summer. Bernard Lafayette, who's very famous and one of the people who wrote Buses Are Coming. James Lawson and C.T. Vivian, who was got the Presidential Medal of Freedom from President Obama a few years ago. Now, this is like 2 weeks later, and you can see the movement, I mean, the Freedom Rides is sort of in full effect now. Now that they know they're going to get arrested in Jackson, they just start sending people in. Buses are coming. So you get the first group on June 8th is flown in from Montgomery to the Jackson Airport. That's Percy Sutton on the second mugshot on the top. The second group has come from on a train from New Orleans into Jackson. And the third group is also from a train from Nashville into Jackson. Those are the three primary staging cities, Montgomery, Nashville, and New Orleans. People would get there and then be sent into Jackson to get arrested. This is, Now, and then on the feature pages, as Hazel mentioned, I have portrait, new contemporary portraits of the writers. This is John Lewis, of course, on the balcony outside of his office in Washington. This is LeVon Brown, who was a high school student in Jackson when he got arrested. And this is Carol Silver, who graduated from the University of Chicago and was already kind of working in the movement. She had an extensive career in the movement, was also served for a while as a city councilor in San Francisco. She's photographed in Parchman when we took the Freedom Riders, when the Freedom Riders came back for the 50th anniversary issue, 50th anniversary event. We took them up to Parchman where they had been incarcerated for a number of weeks in the summer of 61, and I was able to grab a few portraits on the fly as they were standing in their old cells. Pretty amazing. Now, like I said, the mugshots really are at the heart of this project, quite literally. This is a mugshot of Helen Singleton as a young college student from California. And you can see the mugshots are kind of, they're documents and photographs at the same time. So this is a document that's been punch-holed for some reason, not sure why. It's also been stapled. So, the repressive surveillance state is in effect here. On the back of the mugshot, what's stapled to it was this information. Her full name, date of birth, current address, birth city, etc. So this is where I started. You know, the back of all these mugshots, printed them all out, made a spreadsheet, and got to work. And, you know, if you have somebody's full name and date of birth and the internet, you can do a lot of damage. But it's also a photograph at the same time as a document. So look at the expression on her face. I mean, it's kind of amazing, right? I mean, here she is. She's just been arrested in Jackson, Mississippi in 1961. This is not a good idea for her, right? And yet, that's not what she's saying to us with her face, with her eyes. She's saying, like, I know something that the jailers don't know. I know something that the police don't know. And so it's really remarkable that we have these images today to look at, to ponder, to think about. I mean, this is literally from the front lines of battle. And the mugshots, if you kind of, tear them apart a little bit and play with them, they begin to sort of, you know, you can sort of have a little fun with them and think about them more as photographs. I made this mural a couple of years ago, and you can see, like, a lot of people here, they were ready to, you know, engage with the camera. That was part, in a way, not really thought about, but it was part of their practice. It was part of their, you know, hijacking the process. They were all getting arrested, jail, no bail. They were filling up the jails in Mississippi. They were trying to hack the system. And so being present for us years later in their mugshot is part of that. There's John Lewis again in the middle on the left. I love Leo Blue. I never got to meet him. He died. He's got a great shirt on, polka dots. That's the 60s. This is Stokely Carmichael in the bottom left. Go Bronx Science. Helen again here. And then when they turn their face away from the camera for profile, these are so, I don't know if they're very tender photographs. I mean, they're sort of, they can't defend themselves with the gaze anymore. The camera, even though there's no photographer there, there's somebody pulling the trigger, but you know, you just see these beautiful patterns start to emerge with the hair. And Catherine's, talk about her in a second, Catherine Burks Brooks. So it looks like a Rockwell mural of America. I don't know, these beautiful jawlines. And then you got, that's James Farmer in the middle left there, who was running corps at the time and was created and ran the Freedom Rides. On the lower left there, you got Lula Mae White from Connecticut trying to sneak a peek at us. And right here, we have a Freedom Rider that we're going to talk a little bit more about in a minute. His name is Case Pink, Joe.
Henry Schwarzschild.
So we'll just remember his face. You can talk about the writers, and these are the last two people, then we'll start talking, but talk about the writers and divide them up in different ways. Geographically, about a third of them in Mississippi came from the Deep South, and they were almost exclusively black. A third of the 329 came from the Northeast and Midwest, and about a third from the West Coast. They were half black, half white. Three quarters men, a quarter women, and they were young. More than 40% were under 21. 75% were under 30. So youth make change, and then they live long enough for me to do a project about them 45, 50 years later. There were some adults on this Freedom Ride, you know, people in their 30s and 40s and 50s. I found a few of them. They were still around. But anyway, this is Catherine Burks Brooks. Here's my last point. The other way to really just start to describe them, and this is sort of a general breakdown, is between the people who were already woke in 61 and the people who were about to be woke. Now, Catherine was a native of Birmingham, Alabama. She was a student at Tennessee State in 61. She was a veteran of the sit-in movement in 1960. She'd been arrested dozens of times. She's marched on picket lines, integrated stores and stuff. So she was like the troops. She was well trained. And when the Freedom Rides came along, it was just the next thing she was going to do. And so that really describes almost all the Freedom Riders from the South. You know, they were in college. They were schooled in nonviolence. They were trained in it. They understood the philosophy of it. And they were just ready to go. Catherine still lives in Birmingham today. She continued to work in the movement. And then as an adult, later on, she was both a school teacher and sold Maybelline cosmetics. And I was just with her in Montgomery presenting at the Freedom Rides Museum. She's really a great lady. Now, the unwoke are the people about to be woke. There are a lot of people who, you know, open up a magazine or turn, look at the newspaper in the spring of 1961 and saw the buses burning in Anson, Alabama, the Freedom Rider buses, and they saw people being beat up in Alabama. You probably all remember some version of those images. And even though they had no training in their background, their parents hadn't drugged them to marches, they hadn't done anything necessarily in college, but those pictures made them want to go to Mississippi. This is Judith Freeze Wright. She was just graduated from Smith College. She had totally followed the sit-ins in 1960, you know, through the papers. And then when the Freedom Rides popped up the next year, she graduated. She went south, you know, had no experience in this at all. And talks in the book about her sort of coming into this church in Montgomery, Alabama the night before they go to Jackson and sort of being just overwhelmed by the songs that everybody was singing in this sort of boisterous, almost lusty way and just sort of surrendering to it And it was this moment that transformed her life. She came back to Mississippi to work for over a year with her husband in Freedom Summer. Later in the 60s, she was part of the anti-war movement. In the 70s, she was part of the women's movement. And in the 80s, she did a lot of work for organizations with AIDS. And she talks about that moment of walking into the church and hearing those songs and singing those songs as her political awakening. So this is what the Freedom Rides did. They brought new people into the movement. This is one of the reasons they were very successful. And this is really the 60s. This is what the 60s did for America. Thank you very much. And that's Judith today, or in 2011. You don't normally see people smiling happily in prison, but she was very happy to be back there that day. And she lives up near Boston today. Anyway, that's it for a very quick slideshow about the brides. There's flyers over here on the table, like I mentioned, that you can order for a discount from Vanderbilt. More information about the book. Also, the Freedom Rides Museum in Montgomery, Alabama. I was speaking there, as I said, recently. They gave me some flyers to hand out, so I'm handing them out. I highly recommend going there on the trip, the new Civil Rights Museum in Jackson, and in Montgomery, the new lynching memorial. If you read about that, it's pretty amazing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Eric, for that introduction. Let's get into some of the details. First, I want to thank Benita again for your artistry. Did you choose the songs or did you work together? Wow, could not have been more relevant. It's really extraordinary. Thank you so very much. Let me just say a word about how we came to do this program this morning. Monica Weiss, who is the chairperson of our platform committee, and believe me, a lot of work goes into putting these Sunday platforms together. Those who aren't involved may take it for granted, but there's a lot of work here. Noting that Martin Luther King Day is a week from this Sunday, asked whether I wanted to give a talk on King, and I said, well, you know, I just gave a talk on King here just not so long ago. Maybe what we ought to do is something else, something related to civil rights. And I said, you know, I bet you can find in New York City some people who were involved in the Freedom Rides. And Monica went on a search with her husband, and we didn't find a Freedom Rider, but believe me, we struck gold in Eric Etheridge. This book, by the way, you saw the photographs, is a testament to humanity. It is absolutely, the photographs are absolutely beautiful. And we're a humanistic organization. I've asked Maggie to get some copies to put on our book table. It's about us in many ways. The humanism in it is just really quite amazing. This is what we're going to do. I have a series of questions I wanted to ask Eric, and then this is the type of program, I think, that really invites questions from the floor. So I'll engage Eric, I guess, maybe for about 20 minutes, and then we'll open it up, and then we'll probably try to end this component by about 20 after 12, and then we'll close out our program. Let me just ask you personally, what inspired you to do this?
Well, I'm from Mississippi, I think, as Hazel mentioned, and I had lived in New York for a number of years and was sort of turning myself from a magazine editor into a photographer. Uh-huh. And I was looking for a project to do, and I'd seen a couple of projects, photographic projects, where people were working in archives, you know, with historical images. And I thought they were very successful, and it seemed like a really interesting kind of project to do. And I knew that in Mississippi, we had a thing called the State Sovereignty Commission. You may have probably heard of that. It was sort of our Stasi, created in the late 50s after Brown versus Board to protect the sovereignty of Mississippi, states' rights. It feels like we're living through another one of those time periods today, unfortunately, and it's all very relevant. When the Freedom Riders came to town, they worked hand in glove with the police to collect all the mugshots. And that's why we have this record today, is because of the State Sovereignty Commission. And so I went looking, and this is around 2002 or 3, and I knew that the files of this agency had since been made public. So I went looking in there,
and eventually found, not discovered, people knew they were there already, but for me, found the mugshots. And once I sort of spent a little time with it, I realized it was a kind of a perfect and obvious re-photographic project to try to find as many of these people today and, as it turns out, you know, record their stories and make a new portrait and make a book.
Right. You know, when I think of the Civil Rights Movement, I think of it as framed by the career of Martin Luther King with the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955 and then his death in April 1968. The book documents the Freedom Rides of 1961, which falls right in the middle of that trajectory. And I'm wondering if you can talk, it's a somewhat diffuse question, but whether you can talk about the place of the Freedom Rides in the Civil Rights Movement at that moment as the Civil Rights Movement was evolving, as it was undergoing some internal changes and so on and so forth.
Sure.
How do we interpret the place of the Freedom
Rides? Well, I think the Freedom Rides are really the first major national campaign. I mean, 1960, you got the Montgomery bus boycott and then a few years of activity, but nothing major. And then in 1960, all these young black kids who were in college, I think probably the first of their families to go to school, they were just ready. They were ready all over the place. And it sort of started in kind of like a brush fire in Greensboro, North Carolina on February the 1st, 1960, the sit-in campaign. And everyone just like, we've got to do that. So all over the South, there were these, you know, drugstores, Woolworth, lunch counters, movie theaters, all these, you know, downtown businesses that were going on. But these were all local events, always usually just done by the people who were trained to do them, the college students, and made a lot of change. But at the end of the year, people were saying in the movement, okay, now what? And in a self-critical way, they're going, you know, all these people get arrested, but then they just bail out, and that doesn't seem to be working. So there was this idea from Gandhi, of course, and others, jail, no bail. So fill up the jails, kind of use the system against itself. So that had already been being discussed, and then the Freedom Ride idea was created by CORE because of a Supreme Court decision in the fall of 61. That said, you can't discriminate in bus stations. They'd already said you can't discriminate on buses. So farmers said, aha, this is an opportunity for us. They'd already done a Freedom Ride in 1947 in the Upper South, so there was precedent and this idea was there. So Farmer and CORE said, we're going to go from New Orleans to Jackson, and we're going to just integrate stations along the way and see what happens, and try to draw some attention to the fact that there was the law was that you couldn't do this, but all the southern states were disobeying the law. And to try to get through this quickly, I think it was the first national campaign where this happened. I mean, this is their first, you know, I mean, this is a big story around the world. The burning bus in Alabama, the attacks in Alabama, these created newspaper photographs and TV footage that literally went around the world. And it brought in all these new people to the movement. They were like Judas. They were able to test out in Jackson. They weren't expecting to be arrested, but they were. They said, we're just going to stay here, forget about New Orleans. We're going to jail, no bail. So it gave them the chance to test new theories. And it really kind of set a template for going forward for the kind of campaigns that they would practice in Albany and out in Georgia and Alabama and elsewhere. So it was their fundamental development block.
Right. So, in effect, it was a strategy. The law had just been passed. The law ran interference with 400 years of Southern slavery and segregationist culture, lynchings, the horrors of the South, and so on and so forth. So this was, in a way, a confrontational strategy to basically realize the law.
Right.
To basically make the law substantive and make it real and so forth, rather than something that would remain exclusively on the books.
Right. I mean, another way to think of it was the federal government abandoned the South, say, like by 1875. Right. You know, 10 years after the war was over, they just said, okay, we're not going to enforce any laws down here anymore, any race laws. We're not going to send troops. We can't do that. And so 100 years later, almost, 1961, the civil rights strategy was really to force the federal government to engage again in the South. And they succeeded.
Right. You mentioned CORE and the Congress on Racial Equality and James Farmer. And I want to stop there for a minute and review that a little bit. We think of the civil rights movement, of course, Martin Luther King as the central figure, and we think of the civil rights movement as coming out of the Black Baptist Church. And yet there were many loci of organizations.
Absolutely.
And so
forth.
James Farmer, by the way, was close to the ethical culture movement and was not a religious figure. I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about Farmer, about CORE, and how the Freedom Rides were actually organized.
Well, CORE, I mean, Farmer had actually helped create CORE originally, I think, in the 1940s. I won't give you an exact year because I'm not sure I remember. And so the, you know, it was kind of, it had been around for a while, obviously, 13 years in 1960. But King was getting all the press, and these darn kids in Nashville and elsewhere were getting all the press. SNCC was just now starting to form. And Farmer's kind of going, of course, kind of, well, we've been around for 13 years, but everybody else is getting, it's like Batman, and he's like the Joker in Batman. He's getting all my press. So they were very, all these groups are very competitive with each other. If you go and talk to the students who were coming from Howard or from Fisk University or from Atlanta black colleges, they all have this sort of, you know, like, we sent more people per capita than any other student group in the South, or we had more people arrested, you know, blah, blah, blah. So they're all very competitive with each other. And it was a kind of a loose confederation of organizations. And so CORE thought up the Freedom Rides as a way to get back in the game, in a sense, and to sort of keep things going. And, you know, and I think the Freedom Rides, to sort of extend your question maybe, the Freedom Rides are a really good example of how the ride, how the movement was not necessarily just led by King and other, you know, people. It was led by everybody. And the rides really, we don't have time to go into today necessarily, but if you read a little bit or watch some of the documentaries online, the rides really fell apart after all the violence in Alabama. And it was because of the national student movement, the kids acting on their own, that it was resuscitated and it exists today. So I see King as a very important figure, but from my experience reading this history, people are always like starting a fight, and then he has to go, you know, starting a campaign, starting a war, starting a movement. And then he goes and sort of plays his role of being the interlocutor between Washington and white America and the kids on the ground. Now, that's not always true, obviously, because they created a lot of the Birmingham campaigns and so on and stuff. But a lot of times, he's just running to the fire that some crazy 18-year-old started, and now he's got to try to make some sense out of.
Right.
James Farmer, could you give us some background on James?
No, sorry. I'm a little rusty on that one today. But he was a lifelong member of the civil rights movement, a nonviolent person.
They were in debates.
I don't remember that.
Okay, let's hold off the questions.
Sorry.
That's fine. I want to get to questions from the floor in a little while. Very interesting point, a little wrinkle in this. The title of your book is Breach of Peace. And I was fascinated by the fact that, as you've pointed out, what the Freedom Riders were doing was not illegal, right?
Well, it was illegal federally, but
right.
But it was not really illegal locally, except for they were prosecuted and convicted of it.
Yes, that's right. But they had to. I mean, you make a very interesting point that the state authorities did not want to introduce a racial component into charging them for what they were doing. Because they feared a type of legal backlash in that regard, and therefore they had to charge them with something. Disturbing the peace, and that's where you get the
right,
title.
Yeah, which is a great title. I mean, we should all be disturbing the peace.
Let's talk about the nitty-gritty of what actually happened there. This is a frightening moment, Mississippi burning. You're going down to the Deep South. You're challenging, again, the racism, the hatred, history, which is 400 years of ugliness and violence. What were the, talking about the Mississippi ride, what were these people met with as they went to Mississippi? I mean, what was the environment? What type of, how did law enforcement behave? How did the public, the bystanders, the racists, how in effect did they relate to these outside agitators coming in and...
You know, the backdrop is that, you know, for three times in a row in Alabama within a few days, the rioters were beaten, attacked, almost killed. And again, as I said, that made national news. So when they came into Mississippi, and international news, when they came into Mississippi, Mississippi was determined to defeat them a different way. You know, we're not as dumb as those people in Alabama are.
Right.
So we're just going to lock them up, and that'll show them, you know, how clever we are. And it was actually a deal worked out between Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy, and one of the U.S. senators from Mississippi at the time. And so they just put them all, they convicted them of breach of peace and threw them in jail, and they go, ha, 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 aren't we clever? And therefore they created, really, the Freedom Rides. You know, so then the movement had this chance to do jail, no bail. They really decided within a day or two of getting locked up what was this new strategy, and they started writing songs like, because we're going to sing in a minute, buses aren't coming. And then it was really, you know, partly an organized effort from CORE in New Orleans, the student movement in Nashville and Alabama, to get people to keep coming into Mississippi. But also it was people like Jude Freeze Wright just going, I'm going, how am I going to get there? And they would figure out some way to get to Nashville or to get to Montgomery or get to New Orleans, and then they'd be put into the machine that would feed them into Jackson to get arrested.
Right.
And they were, so everybody was arrested. A few people were beaten in jail. You know, the little woman from Mississippi, from New Orleans, was like just popped upside the head when she wouldn't say yes sir or no sir to the police and the guards. That was always a bone of, you know, that was always a pressure point. But there was never anything like the violence in Alabama. It was all just, they took their clothes away from them in Parchment, they took their mattresses. They turned the water hoses on them a few times. A couple of guys got whacked around a little bit.
How long were they imprisoned and how did they get out?
They were all imprisoned for about 6 weeks between Jackson and Parchman, the prison in the Delta. They had to bail out at 6 weeks to preserve their appellate rights. There was a lot of backing and forthing legally between CORE and Mississippi to try to maneuver for advantage. But they all basically did 6 weeks.
Your book, of course, is filled with human stories. Could you just tell us, Eric, two or three that really impress you, make the deepest impression?
Sure.
Impressions. Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of great stories. I mean, do you want me to do, should we do Schwarzschild?
Well,
first,
tell us about, because I want to add a little bit and bring him into ethical culture.
This okay.
And overlap.
Well, maybe we should start with him. There's a guy, I pointed out his mugshot, I never met, who died before I started my project. It was named Henry Schwarzschild, and he was probably best known, he lived in New York, and probably best known as, he organized the ACLU's project against capital punishment for years and years. But he was originally born in Germany, in a sort of very distinguished intellectual family in Germany, and who got to New York just before the war. And there were several freedom riders who escaped Europe just before the war or after the war had started as children, who then brought that experience into the rides. And I came across this later just doing some research. It's in a book, but Schwarzschild talked about why he went to Mississippi, and it's really one of the great answers. It's a little long, so I'm going to read it to you. Just take a second. But it resonates with a lot of the other comments that I've heard from writers over the years, and it's humbleness primarily, but in other ways as well. He said, I do not think that my participation in the Freedom Rides made an appreciable difference to the inevitably successful outcome of the struggle. Nor did I expect it to heal the wounds of which the white majority has for decades inflicted on the Negro. I went to the South in inadequate obedience to the biblical demand to do justly. I went as a Jew who remembers the slavery of our forefathers in Egypt, and who went and who wants to obey the injunction to consider himself personally liberated from Egyptian slavery. I went as a Jew in response to the prophetic question, are you not as the children of the Ethiopians to me, O children of Israel? My participation in the Freedom Rides was an act of faith in the validity of a moral act. I went because I needed to go.
Right.
Which I think is incredibly moving.
I'm really tempted here, and I don't want to steal the morning, it's yours. But I knew Henry Schwarzschild very well. I was too young to participate in the civil rights movement, but I was very active in anti-death penalty work, and it was through that work that I worked together with Henry Schwarzschild. And he was very, very smart. He was the director of the National ACLU's Anti-Death Penalty Project, and in the late 70s, I was Amnesty International's national coordinator against the death penalty, and then was the New Jersey coordinator of our statewide coalition in the early 1980s, and it was through that work that I got to know him. And he was a very principled, dedicated guy, very stubborn, sometimes personally difficult to get along with, but he was very committed to what he believed in. And I'd like to say that his brother was actually a very noted Reform rabbi, and as you noted, Henry had a strong Jewish identity. Yet when he died, he chose to have his memorial right here at the Ethical Culture Society, which is very interesting in terms of this.
Absolutely.
Right, which is quite interesting. I have to mention someone else too. I'm stealing the show here for a moment. But somebody who is personally very important to me, who is in your book and Freedom Rider, and that's a guy by the name of Byron Bear. Byron Bear was lived in Englewood, New Jersey, and he for many years was my state senator. And I knew Byron very well. He was a progressive. He was imprisoned once for trying to support farm workers. He broke the law, civil disobedience, taking some of these principles, and in South Jersey tried to support farm workers in New Jersey and was arrested and went to prison when he was a state senator. And Byron invited me to be a writer for him, to work on his staff, to write position papers. And I'm happy to say that I officiated at Byron's oldest daughter's wedding, and another daughter is currently on the Board of Education in the city of Hackensack, where I live. So I was happy to see Byron Bear.
I met Byron right at the end of his life, and so I didn't have a chance to talk to him too much, but he's a fascinating fellow, and I talked to him, a lot of the other writers about him. But he was another writer who was woke by the Freedom Rides. I mean, it really completely changed his life. And when he came back from Mississippi, he threw himself into politics and into CORE. The issues of CORE in northern states was a lot of job stuff, job, you know, equality and housing. And as Joe said, he was in the state legislature as a representative and then as a state senator for years.
Right.
But totally life-transforming.
Right, very good. I have a question. One thing that struck me in the book and what you presented before is how extraordinarily integrated and racially balanced the Freedom Rides were. It seems almost like a unique moment in American history where you had an equal number, as you pointed out, of whites and blacks. I'm wondering if you can comment on that.
I don't know how, you know, I don't know if anybody can take any credit for that other than just the people who got off their butts and went to Mississippi. I just think it was the way that it sort of worked out that time, but absolutely it was whites and blacks. Several instances in Jackson of the police telling white women that they were actually black and they were going to be put in the black cells. So a lot of weird kind of racial categorization mistakes going on by the police department. Now I'm white. It was, they were always divided in the jails. Black men, white women. They were a little more closer to each other once they got into Parchment, but they were always segregated by cells.
No, but it seems to me, I guess the point I'm making, Eric, it seemed to be a moment of unique idealism in American progressive politics where you could have whites and blacks cooperating together in such equal proportions. I mean, was there any claim that this was a white dominant movement? Or
I think, well, I mean, that's a longer conversation, a different conversation about, you know, the movement itself is like, what is it going to take to keep making progress? You know, that was a big question about Freedom Summer in 1964 was, do we include white people? Do we need white people to come to the South to get attention, to be martyrs? But I think that's, you know, I don't know if I can really speak to your question directly, but it is a larger theme in the movement. And certainly several years later when the whites were kicked out of SNCC, you know, things tended to resolve themselves that way later in the 60s.
Yeah. Just a few concluding questions for me. What was the contribution of the Freedom Rights to the broader civil rights movement? I mean, how is it understood in terms of...
Well, I think, you know, as I was saying earlier, I mean, I think, you know, the ability to sort of roll out their strategy and their message at a national scale was very important and showed them that these things would work at a national scale. Jail, no bail, nonviolent direct action, and that, you know, people would join them. The other, you know, it had other lasting effects indirect by changing the lives of all these people who then changed our lives by working in state government, by working in the women's movement, the anti-war movement, the, you know, in the fight against AIDS. Another interesting thing that people don't know, unless they've read deeply, is that Mississippi was very closed at this time. You had sit-ins in Tennessee, Atlanta, the Carolinas, Virginia, Maryland. But in the Deep South, Mississippi was really locked down. And so when I interviewed a lot of the people who joined the rides as high school students from Mississippi, you know, they would say things like what Jesse Davis said to me. You know, so I remember when I first heard about the North Carolina sit-ins, I said, man, when can something like that happen to Jackson, come to Jackson? Because they knew that a solitary effort would just, you know, end up them being beaten or killed. You know, Emmett Till was first and foremost in their minds. I mean, this was just a few years ago. So they needed the organization. And so these kids all came out of high school, a couple of junior high school students. They joined the campaign. They got arrested, and then they got thrown in jail with Bernard Lafayette and James Bevel and James Lawson and James Farmer. And for a while, Parchman that summer was Movement University. You know, they were all sitting there all day long with nothing to do, so they would talk about how to organize, how to do the movement. And so all these high school kids come out of Parchman at the end of 61, the end of the summer. They're now the movement in Mississippi. So they go into Macomb, they go into the Delta, they go all over the state, and they're now the civil rights leaders. So the movement really transformed Mississippi. And I think that the movement, probably the biggest lesson, and it's in your program today, and I don't have it in front of me right now, but it's the quote from Diane Nash, who was a major figure in the student movement in Nashville, and one of the main organizers of the campaign and Freedom Rides, although she was never arrested in Jackson. And she said, you know, we presented the South with a new, you know, alternative, either desegregate or kill us. And they really, you know, the lesson they thought they were learning was that, you know, you cannot let a campaign be stopped by violence. So after all the violence in Alabama, they had to keep the campaign going, else they would just stay where they were. And I think that lesson was probably, you know, one of the most important that they learned, that you have to keep going forward. Okay.
One final question for me, and
sure,
it veers into the personal a bit. We're in a very dark moment of racist reaction in this country that is very despairing and very frightening. After all, many of us thought with Barack Obama, that maybe this country was beginning to turn a corner with regard to our ugly racist legacy, and then lo and behold, look what we have now. What relevance can we draw from the Freedom Rides that might be usable in this moment? I know it's a hard question.
Well, no, actually, it's a good question. It's an easy question. There are two things.
Well, and then I just want to end the question. Does it
Did the Freedom Ride speak to your sense of, personally, speak to your sense of optimism given what we're confronted now?
I don't know if I'm optimistic.
Well, okay.
But yeah, I try. But I mean, I think that the thing to remember, and it's in my introduction to this one, that the Freedom Riders were widely hated by pretty much everybody and attacked in 61. You know, today we celebrate them as we should. They've all been on Oprah, etc. And we're like, we love the Freedom Riders. But in 1961, they were, let's see if I can dig it out real fast. You know, they were attacked by the New York Times, they were attacked by the government, they were attacked by the media, they were miserable frauds, they were deranged mammals, they were bands of insipid futilities, they were meddlers, bleeding hearts, publicity seekers, misfits, dupes, and un-American. Okay? This is the same language that we've always heard for people who try to make change, the same language that we heard about Black Lives Matter. You know, whoever's protesting is doing it wrong. You know, Colin Kaepernick, he's doing it wrong, right? This is always what they say. So don't listen to that. The kids are right. Whoever's protesting is probably doing it right. If they're kind of making it uncomfortable and inconvenience, that's probably a good thing. So I think, you know, the writers, you know, they're just their personal courage and their willingness to put themselves in harm's way tells us we should, you know, that's a model for each of us. And also that the point is for you to do something, not to look for the leader to do something. The point is to get on the bus and go.
That's great.
Time for some questions from the floor. Yes, this young lady over here. Yeah.
Yes, I probably should remember, but I don't. What was the effect of the rides on interstate travel?
Okay, so they won. They forced the federal government to get involved. And in September of 61, because Bobby Kennedy had kind of made this happen, the Interstate Commerce Commission issued new rulings and policy that all stations in the South, bus stations, train stations, airports, could not be segregated anymore. So it was still a matter of enforcement, but they won.
Right, very good. Bob.
I was in Jackson in the 90s, and it appeared normal, but I knew it wasn't. Things were going on. Was there anything major going on in Mississippi in the 90s?
Not like this. So, I mean, Mississippi is still kind of in a kind of post-Reconstruction state, I think. You know, I think most of the South is in a post-Reconstruction state. I've been reading a lot of Reconstruction history lately, so that's my bias right now. You know, all these governments are still predicated on the constitutions that were written after the Redemption, after the whites took power again. And Mississippi is still a state that solves primarily for whiteness first, just why, you know, economically, otherwise, health, education, it's not so good, because you have to solve for whiteness first. I think there's actually more stuff going on now with new generations of politicians, like, not in Mississippi, but Stacey Abrams, you saw in Georgia, but people like that coming up, second and third generations after the movement, that I think I'm encouraged about. And the Take Down All the Monuments campaign is also very encouraging.
Abe,
I'm sorry. Yeah. I was running a community center in East Harlem in the 60s, late 60s and early 70s. And white women came up for jobs because they were thrown out of the movement by Stokely Carmichael and others. And what I found, because I've been involved with African Americans on my job and in my own family and in my neighborhood, that there have been swings. And there was a swing there at that time, and there was another one with the Black Muslim movement, and there is one now. to the riot, the nonviolent movement. They said it didn't stop the cops from killing innocent blacks. And I've been to forums and meetings where it was very hard for me to make a point that the nonviolent movement is the, really the only way to go.
I mean, nonviolence was very hotly debated by the freedom riders and by everybody in the movement. And you know, you had true believers like James Lawson and others at that level who really, you know, who really bought into that. That was their, you know, that was their religious feeling. I mean, it's a very religious space. And then other people who were like, well, I don't know, but I really want to be nonviolent. You know, Catherine Burke Brooks, you know, we talked about earlier, she, you know, she would tell me stories about, you know, people coming at her with cigarettes to, like, stab her, and she was like, I just want to, like, punch that guy. So, but a lot of them knew that, you know, where they were willing to try it in the moment. It's like, well, this seems like an idea that might work, and I'm willing to test it. But I do think it's, you know, it is an amazing concept, and it is very active. It's not passive. But people, you know, there is a lot of debate about it. There was a lot of debate about it then. I can see why you'd be hard. It's a hard sell today. I mean, it's a really, it's a radical idea, and it's hard to, see how that works. But it does. It did.
Okay, one last question, Ken.
How important do you think Brown versus Board of Education was? Was that a major stimulant for the movement?
Well, it was certainly a major stimulant to the anti-movement. So, you know, after Brown versus Board of Education, right away in Mississippi you had the Citizens Council being started, which was kind of, people called it the Uptown Klan. It was the bankers and the insurance salesmen and whatnot who banded together to sort of keep things as the way they were. And then you had, and then a few years later, the Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission was formed. So it was certainly, you know, in Mississippi we used to call it, I forget the day of the week that the decision came out, but it was always known as Black Monday or Black Thursday, I can't remember. But I think what was really motivating the students and the Freedom Rides and the participants, the black participants in the Freedom Rides, they wanted freedom now. They want it now, okay, not a year from now. Just don't go slow anymore. They want it now.
They wanted desegregation.
Well, they wanted everything. They wanted to be able to vote. They wanted to not be killed for voting. They wanted to be able to, you know, get a job and make money. They wanted everything, and they want it now. So I think, yes, in the sense that it was, you know, progress, it was inspiring to them.
Hey, you know, this morning has been a gift. This has been extraordinary.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you so very much. Thank you.